Going for blood, 500 terabytes a day, and Google Hangouts, you guys have some real competition. Hello everyone and welcome to Tech and Coffee's Tech News Week. I'm your host, Duke Carrico, and it's time to talk tech news. How's everyone doing?
Doing well.
Great. Excellent.
Very good. I'll tell you what, let's just start down the line and everyone introduce yourselves. Where are you from?
Yep, my name is Bruce Turner. I'm in Lynchburg, Virginia, the Hill City.
My name's Guy Cook. I'm based out of Manchester, Washington, which for sake of a map is kind of by Seattle. And I've been a web developer for about 15 years.
Jeff Zayas from the San Francisco Bay Area. We'll call it the Left Coast.
I'm Matthew from a little town in France and running web development.
Very, very good. Very good. How's everybody's week been so far?
Real busy. Lots of little things that have just amassed and happened all in the same time interval. So it's been quite a busy week.
It's been kind of like Christmas, you know, how you were when you were a kid, you look forward to opening up the toys and unwrapping them. We've had a lot of neat things to unwrap this week, so I'm happy like a kid on Christmas morning right now.
Absolutely, and we're going to talk about at least one of those things. What about you, Jeff? What kind of week you having?
You know, it's not too bad. The weather here has been, you know, I always go with the weather because, you know, this is the where the fog comes in is in the summer, right? So so far so good. It's, you know, it's down in the 60s and, you know, not the freezing cold like San Francisco usually gets. So, yeah, it's been a nice week. And America's Cup is just kicking off. So.
Okay, so what kind of buzz is out there on the left coast when it comes to Samsung and Apple and this what they're calling the tech trial of the century?
You know, I think here, you know, actually it makes the media here, so because it is the, you know, the Bay Area, so all the local news stations cover it. That's number one. Number two is, you know, I think it's just people are, like we've been talking about, are just tired of the whole patent debacle and thinking that things need to change. So here, it's in the news. You're just going to wait to see what happens. But other than that, you know, business as usual.
Okay. You know, we talked a little bit last week about the trial, and it sounds that it's in the jury's hands now, and I think they were given like a 93-page document worth of instructions on what all they were going to be looking at. I'm kind of anxious to hear how it's going to come out, but I guess one question that I would just pose to the group, what's going to happen if Samsung wins?
They'll be appealed.
They'll save a bunch of money.
I think that Jeff said it right. I don't think this is going to be over one swoop. They're just going to say, okay, this is what happens, because they've got too many dollars on the table. Nobody is going to like the decision.
Yeah.
This is like round one of the battle, I think, is what Jeff's saying. Is that pretty accurate, Jeff?
Yeah, I think so, you know, because, you know, it's like you said, there's just it's the livelihood of both companies that are at stake, right? And there's a lot of money on the table. So anything they do, I think is going to be looked at again. Any kind of decision they make, they'll find something to, you know, appeal it. Either side.
So likewise, you believe that if Apple wins, Samsung will appeal too, right, Guy?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They have a responsibility for all their employees, all the investors. It's not going to be open and shut.
Well, what's the amount of damages that Apple's seeking? Was it like $200 billion, something like that?
I don't have that number in front of me. I couldn't tell you.
That's a heavy number. Yeah.
I've been sort of ignoring it, Bruce, because I'm done. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Right.
is just so many things on the plate and something had to get left behind. It was one of the first ones I chose to leave behind.
You didn't want to know about the patent.
I was more excited about the new Amazon announcement, and I don't know if we're going to talk about new things. I should save it, but their new archiving service is announced called Glacier. And the thing that caught my eye was 1 cent is 1 gig for 1 month.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive.
Well,
that's,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that's, but the uploads and downloads are at Glacier speeds.
Wow.
Just joking, of course.
Results will vary.
Yeah, results will as the cloud starts to shrink.
Well, I'll tell you what. I personally am looking forward to this trial being over with so that we can get on with Motorola suing Apple.
There you go. You know, I like this Verge article, the way they highlighted in big, bold, all caps, some of the sayings when they got into the closing arguments, you know, like, no Samsung witness ever sat in that chair and said these designs are not similar. They've spent $1 billion mimicking our designs. Competition is what built this country. Let's not pretend you can patent a colorful row of icons. All this copying nonsense is hand-waving from Apple. It took Apple 5 years to create this revolution, and Samsung took 3 months to copy it. That's the truth, and that's simple, clear, and undisputed.
Yep, that's pretty close.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to give the Academy Award to Bruce Turner. Not even vote. He gets it. That's it.
But that's what the lawyers do. Their second degree, like they get a law degree, but they minor in drama.
Yeah.
They do bring it.
You know, this quote here, let's have Samsung compete freely in the marketplace instead of Apple trying to stop it in the courtroom. You know?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, we should have, I don't know when they're predicting, but I'm thinking in the coming days, we should have the jury coming back and we're going to learn and, what a good tech news week that'll make.
Oh, but yeah.
Do you think they get a fair trial there? I mean, you're in the same, you know, that area where, you know, Apple's located close by and everything. What about the jury pool?
I think the jury pool is, you know, they're smart people here. You know, not here, but I'm just saying. They're, you know, they can be tech savvy. But, you know, Samsung just signed a deal with the city of San Jose to move their technology infrastructure to San Jose, California, and mm-hmm. you know all their development there. So that was kind of interesting that they're putting a foothold right into Silicon Valley.
Uh huh. I've heard of another tech company that just bought land for a data center in Oregon. That's
IBM.
Rackspace is going to move into Oregon. Mm-hmm. I mean, at this point, it's just they've bought some land. They're not saying it's going to be so many square feet. It doesn't say anything beyond they bought land, but that was an interesting bit of news I saw today.
Yeah, you know, I'm just thinking about it. I wonder if they asked them on the jury, what kind of cell phone do you use? Do you have an iPhone? Do you have an Android? You know,
when they're interviewing the jurors?
Yeah, did they knock them off for having a device by that company because they're biased?
Yeah, did you own an iPhone 3 or 3S versus a Samsung Galaxy S?
Better yet, did you own a Newton?
You know what? I think.
And you're still mad.
I think this trial is not good for advertisement for Apple and Samsung. I think it can only give a bad image of both of them. I'm still willing to get the new iPhone, but with all that jazz about their first creation, etc., I'm still bored of this aggressivity. You know, I think Windows will come with Windows Phone 8, and that could be a serious contender to this two two biggies.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. That's a good point. I think that there's a part of me that thinks, is Microsoft winning in this instance? Are they just sitting back on the fence like you two other operating systems for mobile devices, you get it all hammered out and get it all figured out. We're going to sit back here and just take what's left because there might be a lot left.
I mean, the third position is still is still up for grabs, right? I mean, what else is there?
Windows will come with a new operating system, and Apple and Android will still have the same iOS and Android. So,
doesn't it come down to the cell phone operators, basically betting on that operating system, versus Android?
I don't know, but I think Windows has serious chances to play because of the demonstration that I've seen in the last Microsoft conference, mobile conference. That was pretty impressive what they did with Windows Phone 8. So I'm still playing fine with the new iPhone or Windows Phone. I'm not still decided.
I'll have to say the Windows phones that I played with, I haven't been able to spend a whole lot of time, but I think I really like the Windows Phone interface. I really do. I think it's going to make a grand tablet interface. I'm just not so sure about that same interface on a desktop, but I've been very impressed with those Windows phones that I picked up.
The project I'm involved with in China, and any of the countries that have higher bandwidth speeds available to them, like Jeff was alluding to earlier about uploads, mobile is the future there. And I think that the guy that has, and Larry's probably read about this too, right? That the mobile computers are the future, right, Larry?
No, Larry said.
He says no. Well, I asked him, so I just wanted to get that question in there.
Okay. I'll tell you what. Let's move on to another topic.
Okay.
Okay.
This is going to be, I was really shocked when I read this today. This is what Facebook deals with every day. Okay? 2.7 billion likes. 300 million photos uploaded, 500 terabytes of data.
That's amazing, huh?
I think it's truly amazing. I mean, and listen, this is what we've learned about Facebook. If this is Facebook's traffic, I wonder what kind of traffic Google sees when you take all of their services and lump them up and start adding that stuff up,
I think they have issues sometimes, I think there was issues with a couple days ago with the processing of the videos on the on-air videos, having them before they would come up instantly, and then all of a sudden, it took days for the video to be rendered.
Yeah, I can't remember. I saw some stats here not too very long ago. It was I'm sure this isn't exactly right, but it was like there's like 23 hours of video uploaded to YouTube, like every second. I mean, it was something like that.
Yeah, I've heard that too. The 23 hours rings a bell.
Yeah. So it's just amazing. I've said this before. Google probably knows more about me than I know about me.
And you've been blocked.
Yeah.
And you still won't be able to get that vanity URL.
Probably not. Yeah, but I just thought these were amazing numbers, and I thought they were worth mentioning. By the way, I pulled this off Gizmodo, If anyone wants to go look at those numbers, there's some other information there. But basically, if you try to break that down to all the Facebook users, what that the way that it all works out is that each individual Facebook user is doing 3 Facebook likes a day and will upload 1 picture every 3 days. How many pictures have you uploaded to Facebook today, Jeff?
None. Ask me how many I did yesterday. None. Want to go for the trifecta 3 days ago? None. So I'm not active on Facebook at all, really. So that's, you know, I'm not a good representation of that. I'm not part of the 900 million.
Okay. Matthew, do you have a Facebook page?
I have a Facebook page, yes. I have 2 for my site.
Okay.
And I regularly post my update to my site. But for sharing options of Facebook, I don't post so often on Facebook. I post when I'm sure I can find a public on Facebook, and that's more and more restricted because of opinions and etc. I prefer Google Plus now, which is the greatest platform for sharing and updating any news.
Okay. Hey, Larry, what about you? You've got a Facebook page, don't you, buddy? Yeah. Okay, Larry, how often do you use your Facebook page? Do you use it every day? Okay, all right. Very good. Thank you, Larry. Jeff, do you even have a Facebook page? I can't remember if you do or not.
Yeah, I do, but I occasionally I'll get that email saying I have notifications or, you know, and then I'll go in and check. But I'm not active on it. I've made a lot of posts to people telling them I'm not active on it, and you know, I just don't do it. I don't know why.
Yeah, I use Facebook every day primarily because some of the groups that I lead during the week, we have group pages, and so we interact with each other, you know, every day, posting things, information, encouragement, that sort of thing. And then the college I went to, which is having a big reunion in Philadelphia in about a week and a half, there's a group page for that too, where they're, you know, sharing information about, you know, the DoubleTree Hilton, where we're going to be staying, and different things that need to be done. So it's been, you know, it's been pretty important to me and for communicating on that level. As far as family and friends and just posting, not all that much.
Okay.
But I tell you what I did post about today, and this would be a great segue. I was sharing with a rather large organization that does a lot of group online type things, and I shared with them about Zoom.
Okay. Let's talk about Zoom because, let's see, I don't think Larry or Matthew have had a chance to try it yet, but I know the others of us have. Bruce, why don't you just tell us a little bit about what Zoom is and your impressions of it?
Well, it was yesterday morning. One of the first things I do after I get up, I browse my Twitter feed, and I noticed because I turn the Wi-Fi and the data off on my phone at night, so I don't get all these notifications interrupting my sleep. But when I turned it on, I see the little notification thing come down from the top. Notice that you had shared something on Google Plus. So, you know, if Duke shares something, he's like E.F. Hutton. You know, when E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody listens. And so I went there and I saw, you know, posting about this Zoom and video conferencing. Well, you know, it's hard to really get a good read on a website on such a small device as the iPhone. But I clicked another button and emailed the article to myself. When I got in to start my workday and I went to my email, I looked that up. I thought, holy smokes, this is really looking like something serious and interesting. So I went to the website. I downloaded the client. And I began to look at it and invite some folks in to share. And lo and behold, here's this incredibly high-quality video screen-sharing conference without the limitation of 10 like we have in the Hangout tonight, but with 15 And Duke, you were part of that test we did last night. We had 13 people in this Zoom video conferencing client, and I think we were all pretty much blown away.
I looked at it this morning, Duke, when I was in Tech and Coffee in the Hangout, and Bruce came in and said, "You got to see this." And I said, "Okay, it's the quiet time in the morning, taking a break." So I went and looked. I never had imagined that video streaming could be that good as what I saw with Zoom US. I've been on computers since 1981. I've never seen a computer stream video with the quality that this does.
Yeah, I gotta echo that. It was I think 720p quality on the video stream, and it was just spot on. It has a couple quirks, right? But you know, out of the box, I think they hit a home run. I mean, directly out of the box.
Oh yeah, grand salami.
What are the sharing options about screen options? What can you share with it?
Everything. You can screen share, and Bruce was sharing his desktop, and the clarity on that thing was just amazing. It was the text; you could read it perfectly. It was pretty cool.
And it's the full screen. The entire whole screen is what he's sharing.
And I think, Bruce, what were you saying about the footprint?
Well, it's a couple of things. On the screen sharing, you can share, like I've got two monitors, most of you guys got two monitors. You can share desktop one, desktop two. You can share an application as well, and it will just show that application, very much like you can do in Google Hangouts. The difference is it pops immediately. And the clarity, it is just like looking at your own monitor. It really is that good. So for training purposes and things like this, I know this is going to become my default platform for my team meeting. I've got remote staff who live anywhere from Florida to Seattle. And to be able to have that quality of video and to be able to share in an instructive way some of the things that I need to share with them is going to be really good. But onto the footprint, and I guess you're asking about CPU. Right. You know, Skype group video with 10, extremely CPU intensive. The Google Talk plugin that we're doing this on right now, very CPU intensive. But this Zoom thing, easily less than half of the CPU processing power needed compared to Google Hangout. So I'm hoping that Google's going to take note of this and step up their game or buy them one.
Seems to be a pretty good technology, apparently. I didn't try it. I didn't hear about it. Didn't hear about it. So I'll check that as soon as I can.
Yeah. No Flash. It's a Java. It's a Java app, that a little small app that you download, and you send somebody the link. They click on the link. They download the little simple file. Now you can go to zoom.us and download the client as well. And you log in with either Gmail or Facebook. Nice thing about that, if you log in with Facebook, there's a tab on the invite list. It'll show all your Facebook friends and whether they're online or not. If you log in with Gmail, it'll show all your Gmail talk buddies, and you can see it there.
Remember the young guy from Tacoma with the glasses, what we showed it to this morning?
Right.
We've used it twice today already. We were setting up SSH access on a shared hosting account. He wasn't real comfortable with all the settings and stuff, so we wanted to show it to him. He says, "Well, can I use that Zoom?" I said, "Good idea." Shared the screen. Yep, dotted the I's, crossed the T's, and what a time saver.
Yeah.
And the quality, imagine it as good as you can imagine it, and then go look, and it's going to blow you away.
Yeah, I think the real advantage is the quality, and also that it doesn't have to join anything to participate, right? They just click on the link. And
like, very user-friendly, very intuitive.
It's a standalone product. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And just like when Guy coughed a moment ago and the video changed to him, that wouldn't have happened in Zoom because it waits about a second and a half to make sure that you didn't just make some kind of a spurious noise. It takes some time, guys, if you've not done it. Go to zoom.us. And go to the support page and then look at their frequently asked questions, look at the knowledge base, and you can make suggestions there. And listen, an Android version is going to come. They said soon they'll be able to support Linux. And somebody put in there about would like to have ability to record what's going on, and they say, stay tuned, that's coming. We're working on that.
Well Duke, what did you think about it, how it looked on the iPad?
I don't know what my video that I was transmitting looked like, but the video coming in from the iPad was just as flawless as it was on the PC. I just want to add, I've been listening to you guys. Last night we did a test. We ended up with 13 people in the room, and the video never stuttered. The audio never sounded garbled. I mean, everything was perfect with that many people in it. And
right.
I'm just going to reiterate something that's already been said. When you do a screen share and you're sharing your screen, there was a lady who was in there last night. When I shared my screen, she really thought she was looking at her computer screen. She did not even realize that I was screen sharing. That's how plain this picture is. This is a new service. You know, they just basically opened up to public yesterday. We were fortunate enough to get in on it. Let's see what it looks like, you know, maybe a few months from now when more and more go to it and they have to scale up. I'm not sure exactly how they're going to monetize it, but guys, out of the gate, if you have a need to video conference, it's I think all around, just with what I played with it, it's better than Skype. The video quality is much better than Google Hangouts, okay?
Sure. So they will have to find their way to success now. If the product is so awesome, they will have to do some great promotion and make the people talk about it, because it seems pretty interesting.
Yeah, there are some flaws, which we discovered today, and right, you can't mute somebody. If someone doesn't know they join, if they join accidentally, and they're... there's a lot of background noise. There's no way to kind of mute them. So there's little things that little suggestions that enhancement they need to do to, you know, and to make it, you know, even better. But, you know, what it is nice. Very nice.
I've got a small complaint about the thumbnails. You can only see four thumbnails, and then you have to scroll to get, you know, the next. But listen, I will take that minor complaint for that flawless video and very, very decent audio any day.
Yeah, we actually saw the stubble of your hair on top of your head there, Duke, because of that video was right there.
No way did you see that. Now, if I took my shirt off, you might could probably see my back hair, but there's no way you saw stubble on my head, okay?
Anything you say, Slick.
Hey, guys. Let's move on to another topic, and that is
Stupid Tech Moment.
All right. Now then, here is our Stupid Tech Moment, and I promise you, this is not a joke. I'm going to share my desktop here. I think. Now, if we were in Zoom.us, you could see this plain as day, but since we're in a Hangout, you might have difficulty seeing this. But I stumbled across this morning, and I really thought that it was a mistake, but I'm gonna prove to you that it's really not.
What's the price?
That price is for this HDMI cable. That price is $934.99.
Oh, that man. Love free shipping,
y'all. Yeah, and it's got four stars on it.
Hey, it says it's a diamond cable. Is it made out of crushed diamonds?
Yeah, it has to be at that price.
Yeah, it's a 2 foot long high speed HDMI cable. And I'm just going to make this comment. I went into Best Buy once I saw that, and I went and looked, and sure enough, guys, they've got $200, $300, $400 cables, and they've got good reviews. So the reason why I picked this for a stupid tech moment is not that this company has a $900 cable on Best Buy. It's a stupid tech moment because this company has a $900 2-foot-long HDMI cable, and there's all kinds of users that are going out there telling about how great these cables are, okay? If that's not some stupid technical people, I'm sorry. I don't care what it's made out of. I can't believe that. Goodness gracious. Hey, I don't like to give $40 for an HDMI cable. There's no way I'd give that much money for it. I don't care if it is crushed diamonds.
You can get a decent HDMI cable for $17.
There you go. Yeah. Okay.
So did you buy one?
I bought one and hooked it up, and another one in case that first one goes bad.
Yeah, you returned it, but you had to pay that 15% restocking fee. Yeah.
For that amount of money, he and his niece could fly to Orlando and do a week at Disney.
There you go.
Yeah. Are you going to buy one of those, Larry? Probably not.
That got him right there. That was probably a no.
Yeah. Okay, I'll tell you what. Moving on. All right. Let's talk about rumors here in a second, gang. And I'll tell you, you know, last week we touched upon a rumor, and it was about Apple cable box. You guys remember that? I know a couple of you were here. And I've since learned that, actually, this is the Wall Street Journal is reporting that basically what this cable box is it blurs the distinction between what's broadcast television and what's streamed content. And the example that they gave is, you know, pick your favorite show, and you can watch this week's episode live, but you would also have access to the back catalog of the previous versions of the season, plus maybe previous seasons. And I've got to tell you, you know, I don't even want to vote on this thumbs up or thumbs down. This is just a rumor at this point. It sounds like that Apple's having trouble talking to broadcasters into it. But this sounds like a very interesting concept to me on how to mend streaming content with broadcast television. And I was just wanting to get the panel's thoughts on this.
All right. Well, Bruce, want to go first?
You know, I guess it really depends on how much content and where you're consuming it is today. There's probably maybe three or four shows that, as far as broadcast television, that are must watch, you know, in our family. I consume a lot more content on my PC or my Roku box, especially with the grandchildren and things like that. So, I mean, I think if they can negotiate, I think it would begin to erase the distinction. And not only would it erase the distinction, but I think the pendulum would begin to swing toward internet TV. And, of course, you know, there's a lot of people with a lot at stake here. What do you think, Jeff?
You know, I'm thinking that it makes sense. I mean, everyone wants this kind of I'm calling it a la carte kind of deal, right? Where you can get certain. You don't need the cable for the, like, we have Comcast here, so you know the Comcast cable is so expensive for TV. But if I had like a table box that I could get my live broadcast of watching the news show that I watch every night, you know, because I want to watch the local news and catch what the weather's going to be and things like that. Mm-hmm. I could conceivably drop out of watching traditional cable TV for internet-based TV because I would want to watch that. Or if they got ESPN or something like that. So they had the live sporting events plus, you know, broadcast local news. I would be in on something like that. But right now, they're, you know, it doesn't work for me because, you know, we watch a lot of things that on our DVRs, basically, and, you know, things like that. So I think it's a good idea. I'll give it a thumbs up if they can pull it off for all the local news and things like that.
Anybody else with any comments on that?
The one piece of the puzzle that hasn't come together yet is the monetization and how do they do the commercials. Because 30-second commercials have an exponential tune-out factor. Nobody's going to sit and listen through a 30-second commercial. They'll skip the ad every time. They're doing it now. That's why they even have the option at the corner. And when you get into the mobile environment.
Say again. I was just going to say, I would envision this to be tied to iTunes to where, you know, you're going to watch the live version with the commercials as they are now, but then you're going to probably pay for those others either per episode or per season, and that's probably how it's going to be monetized.
Well, you know, I don't know if anyone has Comcast, but, you know, they have something called Catch Up, right, which is you can catch up on a season, you know, but it actually, it disables the ability to fast forward. So you actually watch the show like you'd watch it, so you get all the commercials and all that stuff as well. So, you know, that's one way they could do it, right? They could just put that in there and somehow when it plays the local commercials, not the national commercials, they're still in there, or they just play it out. Disable the fast-forward feature.
Yep.
Anything else?
On the TV? On the Apple TV?
Yes.
Well, local programming is going to happen. There'll be a lot more local content generated.
You know, here in France, we've got IPTV. So we don't clearly get what's the point to get the channel on Apple TV, because we have the box for the TV available. For us, TV is working by the wires, so it's already there. I don't see clearly. Maybe it's a question in the States as you're talking about it. But here in France, the question is not really a question of the day. I think TV is available anywhere on the web. The websites are there. Content is there. So I don't really see the point to put it on Apple TV on a special product.
Yeah, I think in the United States we're dealing with we've got the broadcast media here that I'm going to call the dinosaur, and they've resisted really providing any kind of streaming other than the coalition that came to be known as Hulu, which thus far has been a big failure as far as like streaming content. They've tried to charge for it. They've blocked anything Google from accessing it. And it sounds to me that if Apple could get these broadcasters on board, the United States could have it's what it sounds like France already has.
Yeah, that's what they call the triple play or quadruple play. So it's both phone, TV, and internet, and it's a great thing. But the only negative point is when you have an internet failure, you lose everything. That's the only thing really noticeable about it. But when it works, it's great.
Well, you know, we have that here in the U.S. I mean, I actually have Comcast Trip Replay, where I have phone, voice, and data all over my internet connection. And, you know, you bundle that together. But, you know, the problem is you cannot get things a la carte. That's what I would like. I don't really need to have 144 channels. I want to have 20 channels. And, you know, and these are the channels I want to watch. I don't want to pay $60 for 144. I want to pay $30 for the 20 that I want to pick. Right?
There you go. Exactly.
That's. I think that's why the services like Netflix should develop themselves and start to partnership with TV channels to display TV content instead of movies and TV series. It has already started with TV series, but I think they could enlarge the subject by TV content.
Well, you know, the funny thing is the cable provider doesn't want to do it. They say no one can do that, but yet I can order a movie, you know, with one click on cable, right? And I can, you know, and I can have it available for 2 days, or I can go on Netflix and order, you know, stream. So the technology is there. It's just that they haven't come up with a reason besides a public outcry to have it done. You know, they haven't figured out a way to make it, you know, profitable for them. So they want you to, if you want ESPN, you got to pay the premium price. You know, you got to get that next tier of channels for us.
Yeah, I see that with the channels also in France. Interesting channels are often paid content too. You have to buy some options to have it.
Well, I've said this before. I still have a cable subscription, a traditional cable television subscription. And as days go by, I really could do without it and just use the internet because I stream so much content. But there's one thing that keeps me from doing that, and that's live sporting events.
Exactly.
If I had a way to access those live sporting events,
I think I think almost ESPN is coming. I think they have ESPN Live that's on the Xbox, but I'm not too sure if that is like their regular, you know, sports ESPN channel. So
yeah, they've got ESPN 3 that does a lot of live internet broadcasts.
And I'm close enough in to Seattle that I can get the sporting events that are broadcast out of Seattle. The one, unless they're on a blackout or something like that. So if it's baseball, football, etc., I can get it on the local stations.
But can you get Monday Night Football?
Pardon me?
Monday Night Football? That is no
right.
longer
I got one of those analog to digital converter boxes that you get for like $60. Put that into video 2 input on the TV. When I want to watch the Channel 5 news, I just flip over to that, watch the local news. Then I go back to my Roku XS2 and watch whatever stream I want to watch.
But can you watch, like, say, Monday Night Football is on ESPN now, right? So it's no longer on ABC.
I don't watch ESPN. So I don't get Monday Night Football.
So can you?
Haven't tried.
That's the dilemma for me, because for me, I hate to say this, football is king. I'm looking forward to football season. You know, I'm already watching the preseason games.
Well, so. Jeff, I'll tell you what we need to do is we need to open up Zoom.us, and me and you and Bruce, and what we'll do is one of us will stream it into the room. And we can sit and enjoy our favorite beverage, some popcorn, and we can talk and enjoy a good football game because the quality is so good, I guarantee you it'll be worth watching.
I agree, you know, and then the FBI will be breaking down our doors.
Well, no, only the source of the video will be broken into. The innocent people viewing it, like Bruce and I, will just go, hey, we didn't know.
We thought it was a replay.
I thought he had a permission or something.
Said he was Commissioner Jeff Zahas of the NFL.
Yeah, exactly. He's my brother.
Okay, I'll tell you what, gang. Let's go ahead and wrap this one up. Guys, I really appreciate you. And anybody got anything they want the world to know before we close her down?
Zoom on over to zoom.us and
absolutely
experience something really sweet.
Oh, and Michelle Obama will be on Dr. Oz.
What?
No, it's a inside joke to myself. Sorry about that.
Oh, okay.
Hey, guys, you've been watching Tech and Coffee's Tech News Week. We do this every Thursday night at 8 p.m. Eastern. And y'all come back now, you hear? You've been listening to Tech News Week, a weekly series where we talk tech, brought to you by Tech and Coffee, a Google Plus Hangout. We want to invite you to check out our Hangout. You can do so by going to techandcoffee.info and clicking on Join the Hangout, where you can find a link to our existing Hangout. You can also follow us on Twitter and Facebook at TechandCoffee1. We appreciate you joining us, and y'all come back now, you hear?